Welcome to the broadcast this hour, a look at the most highly anticipated film of the summer and the season. It is called The Matrix Reloaded. We'll talk to the producer, Joel Silver, and three of the stars, Keanu Reeves, Laurence Fishburne, and Carrie-Anne Moss. Also a perspective on the film and the phenomenon with Kurt Anderson and Devin Gordon. All about The Matrix Reloaded when we continue. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
The Coca-Cola system sponsors youth sports the world over, like a national soccer tournament for 37,000 English girls and boys. All young people need to be encouraged to keep active, satisfying a thirst for healthy competition. The Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
In 1999, writer-directors Andy and Larry Wachowski conceived a revolutionary approach to filmmaking. It was called The Matrix.
What is The Matrix?
Human beings are a disease, a cancer of this planet.
You take the blue pill, you wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to be. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. The Matrix is a computer-generated dream world, built to keep us under control in order to change a human being into this. I'm trying to free your mind, Mia.
Only try to realize the truth.
What truth?
There is no spoon.
Another one.
Sorry.
The film was a sleeper hit of the year and earned close to $500 million worldwide. The DVD release became the first to sell more than 1 million copies, and more than 1,000 websites and several books were written on the movie. This Thursday, the second chapter of the Matrix trilogy will be released. It is called The Matrix Reloaded, and here is the trailer.
It's him.
Do we proceed?
Yes.
He is still
only human.
All of our lives, we have fought this war. Tonight, I believe we can end it.
That's a nice trick.
Upgrades.
Mr. Anderson.
Surprised to see me?
So he's found a way to copy himself.
Now there's more than one of them.
A lot more.
The machines are digging. They're boring from the surface straight down to Zion.
There is only one way to save our city. Neo.
What happens if I fail?
Then Zion will fall.
They need you.
I need you.
Prophecy is true. What if tomorrow the war could be over? Isn't that worth fighting for? Isn't that worth dying for?
Newsweek magazine declared this is the year of the Matrix. Time magazine put the stars on the cover last week. Enter the Matrix, a video game, will be released this Thursday. There will also soon be a DVD of 9 animated short films that explore the Matrix. And the third installment of the trilogy comes out on November 5th. With us this evening is the film's producer, Joel Silver, and the actors known as Neo, Morpheus, and Trinity, Keanu Reeves, Laurence Fishburne, and Carrie-Anne Moss. I am pleased to have all of them here to talk about what is clearly so far the most discussed, talked about movie of the year. Take a look at Time magazine last week. There's just a slew of magazines and newspaper stories. What happened after Matrix 1? Why do you think this movie had such an impact and became, as some people say, it changed movies forever? Two, it was coming in 1999, a movie that set the direction for the future. Mm-hmm. It was philosophy, it was kung fu.
Action.
It was an epic story.
And visual effects.
It's because these two guys, these two unassuming brothers from Chicago, who really are gifted in how they've been able to put together all of these influences that over their lives just created a sense of them that there was a new way to do things. There was a new way to tell a story, a new way to use visual effects that hadn't been done yet, and that the audience out there was looking for something more than just a dumb action movie, which I have to say I'm responsible for making a lot of them.
Yes.
But they...
Did you know this when you saw this script and when you understood his concept that this could be dramatically different than anything you'd done?
I mean, when you read it, I mean, it was mind-boggling to realize that this, I mean, it existed. And the fact that Warner Brothers was willing to invest at that time a large amount of money to make it was also a miracle. And that they were able to assemble such incredible actors who were willing to devote the time it took, because they had another thought that they wanted these action beats so clear and so well made that they really wanted the actors to spend 8 or 9 months training to learn how to fight. So they didn't want to cut the stuntmen. They wanted the actors to be able to, the performers, to perform these sequences, which had never been done before. And they were very, very clear about that. And so what they ended up doing is crafting this story, making these guys kill themselves to do what they wanted to do. And they came out with something that really was new. It was new.
What's the philosophy, though, that's about here? It's Wachowski brothers like Cornel West.
Love
they
them.
Read all of the philosophers, I'm told, when you talk to them.
Sure.
You know them.
Mm-hmm. Herman Hesse.
Yeah. I mean, Cornel's in
Plato.
The movie. Cornel West is in the movie.
Cornel West.
I mean, look, they synthesize all of these things. They synthesize comic books, they synthesize kung fu movies, and really kind of interesting Western and Eastern philosophy.
Yeah, it's the synthesis, I think, that really is the thing that everybody attaches to.
And what makes it different is the martial arts.
No, it's a combination of all of the elements.
And the visualization of it.
The visualization, the style of the wardrobe, the style of the kung fu. It's basically, it's Hong Kong style kung fu. We're not the first to do it. We're just the first Western people to have done it.
Yeah.
And we worked hard enough so that we were at a level. We certainly weren't at the level of a Hong Kong action star, but we were at a level that no one had seen Western actors perform at before. Mm. It's the costumes. They said, how should it look? Kim Barrett said it should look like an old Western. So we have these long sweeping coats that are really an homage to Westerns.
What do you call
Westerns?
Those coats? They're
dusters.
Dusters, yeah.
But the philosophy just is that it's kind of very simple philosophy about looking into yourself and just, you know, take it.
Well, it's about consciousness too. It's about waking up, and I think that as a you know, the movie, the people going to the movie were obviously affected by the idea of waking up.
Yeah. Who am I?
Yeah.
Why am I here? What am I meant to do?
What have I been told to be? And what have I been told that the world is like? And suddenly waking up and seeing that the world is different.
And I have a choice.
I think that
I have
really
to make
touched
a choice.
People.
Yeah, did you look and think about all this when you accepted the role of Neo in the first place? I mean, what made it appealing to you?
What truth? Neo has a line in the first film in The Matrix, just what truth? And that the searching aspect. I mean, to add on to all of these things, I mean, in terms of the point of the piece, it seems to be, which is really developed as well in Revolutions, is it's the evolution of the birth of compassion, I think, is basically. Through all of these choices, there's a huge part of it about the choices that you make. And I think all of the characters are very ethical and moral in a very positivist sense. You know, they're very moral characters. And I think the journey of the one is someone who comes into compassion in terms of all of the entities that become conscious. He started in a pod, he has his life in the Matrix, he's reborn in Zion, the real world, and then he kind of starts to have contact with the machines and all of these things. He's asking to reevaluate systems, the ways of being, how you're told to be, what you are, what you're told to, you're going to become.
Mm.
And he reevaluates
systems and control.
Systems of control, but they also, I mean, they also, the Neo journey, which I think is also part of the hero journey, is that there are no judgments in an odd way. Even with all of the demons and all of the things that he comes into contact, he has to understand. And through that understanding comes, I feel for Neo, is that there's like a kind of, in a Buddhist aspect, is a birth of consciousness, a birth of compassion through knowing oneself. And he also starts to know the others. Mm. You know, that there's that, I think the central figure for that. And I think because of the what you have in Reloaded and things is you're starting to meet programs that have what we would consider human feelings, even Smith.
Consciousness.
Which they have consciousness. And with the AI,
Agent
the birth
Smith
of the machines.
Agent Smith has consciousness and feelings.
And, yeah, and you're meeting
and
other programs.
Well.
And he's evolving, and that all of these things are fighting for their lives. The machines fought for their lives when they became conscious and enslaved humans. They became oppressors. The oppressors are now the people who are oppressed are kind of being born and going, okay, well, I don't want that anymore. And you're starting to meet different entities in an evolutionary sense that is not just human. It's about, and through that through that perspective, I think you have a collective of, I'm going to say it.
Please.
Love. Yeah. You know, that it's about that.
Who is your character?
Trinity is a warrior. Who is following Morpheus on this journey to save the world.
And falls in love with Neo.
And falls in love with him.
And that relationship is...
Well, in the first movie, I always thought that she had this secret, and she didn't have any time to love. She was a fighter, and love was just not something that she had any time for. And then in these next two movies, it changed very much. And there's a great deal of love in the next two movies. So
when does it change and why does it change?
Well, it changes at the end of the first movie when she acknowledges her secret, which is that she believes that he's the one, because she's been told by the Oracle that she would know who the one would be because she would love him. And that's her purpose. That's her, like, her contribution to the pie, so to speak, is that that she would know, and I wondered if she had known before, the guys that came before, and because there were other ones before the one, but she acknowledges that she loves him, and that's where we end.
And she knows he is the one.
And through her love, she brings him back to life.
There is that religious overtone. I mean, this is described, your character, Neo, is described as messianic, Christ-like,
Savior. Buddha-like.
Mm-hmm. Buddha-like, yeah. I mean, not necessarily Christian, but...
Yeah, it's not just a Christian. Yeah,
it's the great soul. He's the great soul. The one is compassionate, as Keanu's been saying, the birth of compassion. He comes into a state of being where everything is being asked of him. He's being asked to take on the burden of saving the world, and we are the world in certain, you know,
save us from. So is this anti-machine?
No,
freedom.
Not at all.
It's for freedom, fighting for freedom.
And he's also in the action genre, he's the reluctant hero.
Right.
He's the hero that, you know, doesn't really want to be a hero, but he has to do it.
Is it hard for him for Neo to accept this?
It's hard for him until he understands it in a different way, until he comes to an understanding. And so it kind of, he's in the first Matrix, he comes to kind of recognizing that you know, in the beginning of the film, he's afraid of heights. He literally can't fly, you know. And then by the end of the film, he's flying. And, you know, he can free his mind, right. And he can see into the Matrix. He has another understanding of what the Matrix is for himself. Once he has that, he accepts, I think he's accepted being the one. When you see him in his Matrix incarnation, right. He's accepted it. He's part of it. You see him in Zion, and you see the fears of the character because of the responsibilities. People in Zion are coming up to him and want them to help him, and he's very overwhelmed by that. Has he accepted that he will be the savior for the world? He doesn't know. He's questioning. He's still questioning, searching, and finding out. Choices, there are still choices to be made.
Mm-hmm. All right. Roll tape, first scene.
Nice scene.
That was a nice set.
Yes.
Fight scene here. Take a look.
I must apologize. Apologize for what? For this.
I wish you could be here listening to them as I watch that. Just tell me what you said, Larry. I mean, go back to Larry.
This is Hong Kong style kung fu. This is, you know, what Wu Ping and his wire team have been doing for 30 years.
Wu Ping was the instructor,
master choreographer
of all this.
Mm. Action director.
But it's like a dance. It's also like a pas de deux. Yes, it's hard to go to that place, but we can. I mean, it's a you know, very contemporary idea of dance in a very kind of quasi-violent fashion. But this was more of it was just a display almost. No one really was hurt in that.
This was your favorite scene.
My favorite fight scene. It's so beautiful, and it's so difficult because they're both on a little table. You don't realize how difficult it is to do that.
Not to mention, how long did you prepare for this physically to be able to do this?
It was 4 months. We all did 4 months in the beginning, and then they started doing a highway chase scene for 6 weeks. Yeah. And then while they were doing that, I was fighting for another fight. And then after that fight, I had another fight. And then I guess we were about 4 or 5 months in, so I was still training, learned the choreography. So then it was another month just on that fight. So it's about 8 months, I guess.
No. I want to see another clip here. Roll tape. This is one of Trinity, the character Trinity, on her way to save Neo. And there's... Take a look. The scorpion kick.
it's my Wu Ping gave me this kick called the scorpion kick, which is the last kick I do when I reach the guy's legs and I kick him over my, I don't know how to describe
he gave
it.
Us all moves. He gave each character a signature move. Agent Smith is very aggressive and he's
our primary villain.
Yeah. Keanu has a triple kick that he does in both movies. He goes up and there's always a triple kick. Keanu, Carrie-Anne's got a scorpion kick. I have something called an eagle where I go up in the air like this. So it was also, you know, defining for all of our characters, those signature moves.
Who is your character?
Who is my character?
Who is Morpheus?
Oh, I've always thought of Morpheus as being both Obi-Wan Kenobi and Darth Vader sort of rolled up into one, and maybe some Yoda, I don't know. But he's the dark mentor. He's
in search of the savior.
The dark mentor who's going to lead the hero from one state of consciousness. He's going to lead him from one state to another. He's going to lead him to the door, and it is the hero who must make the choice.
Comparisons to Star Wars.
Well, I mean, it's hard. It's always hard to do that. I mean,
it's just generational in terms of the phenomenon that it's
one's become. Analog and one's digital almost.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a completely different time.
I mean, Star Wars is in the chromosomes of all of us. I mean, it's been around for almost 30 years. I mean, it's a whole different world. I mean, what these guys did is they tapped into something that it was ready to come out, and they provided the release. So the movie, which was, you know, not, you know, very well reviewed, it wasn't, people didn't jump onto it immediately as some kind of great thing. Over the period of time that it's been able to percolate in the culture, it has become extremely important.
This came along and sold a million copies.
Yeah, it was the first DVD that did that. And what happened is that it began to collect fans at a feverish level. I mean, there are 1,100 fan sites on the web, on the internet about different elements of this piece of material,
and they all pick up on various aspects
on different things.
It may be one, the beauty of the choreography, it may be the philosophy, it may be just the narrative, it may be the mysticism, it may be the cyber
relationships. The of the characters, and I think also they've synthesized a new way of telling that old story.
Right.
Yeah, feels contemporary. It feels
They've used the technology that's available. And they've used it to tell the story
in a modern way.
It spawns a series of imitators, right?
Oh, that's what happened right away. That's the first thing that happened. The movie came out, and we began seeing things that we had worked really hard to create, you know, everywhere. And at the beginning, the guys were, they thought it was okay, it was cute, and then it was seen more and more, and then it almost became de rigueur. If you made a high-end movie, you had to do things from The Matrix. You had to copy the movie.
That's why they say it changed movies.
I think so. And so their intention on this one was to create technology that could not be copied, which I think we've done, and either because of time or because of cost. And really continue to raise the bar on this kind of filmmaking. To as a filmmaker beyond this movie, as a producer of movies, I'm saying it's hurt all of us because I don't know how to compete with it. It's just impossible. I mean, there's just nothing. There's no way to go beyond this at this point because it's just as big and as far as it can go.
Oh, somebody will find a way.
Good. It'll take them a long time, but somebody will find a way.
It will take them a long time,
which is great. Yeah. But it's going to take some time for them to do it. They're not going to be seeing what you see in Reloaded right away. Okay?
But it's also the humanity and everything plugged in,
exactly.
And the storytelling.
In all of the sci-fi, there is this passion, love, and humanity.
Stories and things that have meaning for us.
I mean, the picture is all things for all people. It's an incredible love story. Yeah. It's a science fiction action movie, and it's this very philosophical,
high-minded kind of thing. It's very funny.
We keep speaking about the humor.
It's hysterical.
We could go on.
we love it.
Well, but it's important to understand it, too.
Yeah.
Where is Zion, and what is Zion?
Zion is the last city. It is the home of the human beings. The machines rule the earth. They reside at the surface, and human beings have gone down into the core, close to the core of the earth, and they live in this tube-like city. The bottom of the rabbit hole, and it's where they're not farmed, as in on the surface there are these, you know, these machines that, you know, human beings are grown. In Zion, people are made the old-fashioned way.
Roll tape. Here is a scene.
We are still here. A message to that army. Tonight, let us shake this cave. Tonight, let us tremble the these halls of earth, steel, and stone. Let us be heard from red tar to black sky. Tonight, let us make them remember. This is Zion, and we are not afraid!
Someone might say, missing from this table are the directors. Mm.
Well, actually,
so where are they, Joel? I mean, these are the guys that you...
This is the only part they don't want to engage in.
The promotion, the publicity,
the understanding. They really feel that the audience should kind of pull out of the movie whatever they want, whatever everyone wants. They don't want to have to explain it. And they don't want to talk about themselves. They feel uncomfortable and embarrassed. So they just said at the beginning of the process, look, we'll do these movies, but we really don't want to do any of that stuff.
And Time Magazine did a cover story, and they wouldn't talk to Time Magazine.
They want people to think for themselves, too. They don't want to...
lead them.
Yeah, they want people to have their own imagination, because you get so many different things. Different people get different ideas about the film, and I think that's important to them.
And that's important to them, for people to really take what they want. They don't want to have to define it for people. They want people to define it for themselves.
This is a trilogy.
Yes.
The third sequel, Revolutions, out on November 5th, has been completed, probably in the process of being edited now, as we speak.
Post. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This will be it?
This story ends in that movie.
What are they thinking about now?
I mean, finishing that movie.
Yeah, probably.
Finishing that movie. Mm-hmm. I started to say, with all this stuff laid in, there's probably a lot of people who just like the adventure.
You know,
this is not a movie that I have to look for all the philosophical references and all of that.
You can just take the ride and really enjoy the movie. Yeah.
Whose idea was the style? Where does that come from?
It's Larry and Eddie Wachowski.
They came up with the idea of the style. Defined as what? How did they see it?
It's just, it's a combination of just... In the Newsweek piece, there was a great double truck where on one side of the paper, the pages showed all the things that influenced the boys, and on the other side showed all the things that they influenced. Mm. And it was interesting how, I mean, it's from all different sources. It was a synthesis of what they were looking to create, and it was the combination of all these elements together that they created.
And the way in which they put those things together, because it created something that seems like it's this brand new thing, and in certain ways it is a brand new thing, but it is born of, you know, various kinds of traditions. It's really amazing.
And Jeff Darrow conceptualized very much the architecture.
That's what I was looking for.
And did the conceptuals for what you see. For Zion, for the ships, he did all of the drawings that...
Jeff Darrow is a comic book artist who worked with the boys for many years and was their
hard-boiled
eyes to create, to show what they wanted it to look like.
Comic book.
Yes, this is the first movie to deliver on what comic books have promised.
Which is?
A kind of seamless, hyper-real action. And a story that cuts across just all kinds of lines, you know, cultural and generational and economic and religious.
Limitations.
There's no limits. As Joel has been saying, it's all things to all people.
The fight scene. No, this is just one, I mean the chase scene. This is just 136 seconds of a freeway chase. You and the key maker, who's Randall Dukim, escape by motorcycle, and then Morpheus saves himself from being run over. Roll tape.
Come on!
The old and the new, saying,
absolutely,
and that imagery,
the old and the new,
with the samurai sword, long sword,
and the Uzi pistol,
into the Uzi pistol, with the with the wagoneer
with the wagon,
the railings flipping over.
And what long
bullet time?
Bullet time is basically an expression that surrounded an image, a special effect, where the brothers could move the camera could slow an event down and move the camera at a different speed, show it changing the perspective. So
they asked the right question at the right time. How do you film a slow motion event and move the camera?
And move the camera at a different speed. So it's playing with time and perspective, which I think oftentimes this film does.
Yeah.
Joel, what's the hardest thing about making this movie?
I mean,
we got great characters, you got a great story.
The logistics of this movie was madness. I mean, we had so much to do, and we had a timeline to do it in. And we started shooting the movie in 2001 in Northern California, where we shot some of the most visual effects, intense scenes. The car chase, this huge fight that Keanu's in with many replications of Agent Smith, and some of the big Zion stuff. And then we shut down for a while, went down to Australia, and shot for close to a year. And at the same time, we made this very, very complicated video game that the boys also wrote, with about an hour's worth of footage in the video game that is kind of parallel to the movie. We did a series of animated shorts called The Animatrix, and we did all of this at the same time as trying to create this whole world and get it all done in a reasonable amount of time to get it out in time for the audience.
When did you decide that, having seen the success of the first one, you would make the two sequels?
Well, the boys did have the full story. They always had the story.
They always thought of it as a trilogy?
Absolutely. And it just, if the first one had not been successful, we wouldn't have seen the rest of the story. I mean, it was kind of what New Line did with Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings.
It's a little ballsier. I mean, they made all three of them
before knowing whether the one would be successful.
Right.
Wow.
But we made the first one, and then their intention was to, once we get the whole group back together again, let's just do both movies. And it was troubling, because you have to realize that when you start a movie like this, the first thing you do is write code. You got to start creating technology, visual effects. And some of the technology in the second movie wasn't started before,
it didn't exist when
we started making it. So it was just madness to put it all together. And the fact that we're sitting here and talking about it, I think is a miracle.
It cost $400 million for the three of them?
No. Oh, for the three of them?
Oh.
Probably a little less than that.
Yeah,
for the three of them.
First one grossed what?
First one did about $170 million domestically and about $270 worldwide.
Do you worry that the anticipation here, on the one hand, all of this is great, but everybody who loved the first one is so high in their anticipation and expectation
that it's hard to... We do not disappoint.
Is the second one better than the first?
The movie will not disappoint people who love the movie. And it will not disappoint people who don't know anything about it.
Why are you so sure?
I've seen it. And that's as a fan.
Sir Lawrence has spoken.
I'm a fan.
You can see how Morpheus is very similar to Lawrence.
That reminds me. Someone said that there is in each of you something that you find in Trinity is in you.
Sure.
What is?
Strength, belief, faith.
And in Morpheus?
You have to ask them. I'm entirely too close to me to know exactly what that is.
What do you think it is, Ken? What is in him that is also in Morpheus, or what is in Morpheus that is in him?
We've spoken about it. He's a great leader. He's a great leader. There's a great givingness to him, but there's also a danger to him in terms of when you were saying. Mm-hmm. But in that, it's not because I want to hurt you, It's not that but there's something about that commands respect, that he's seen something, he knows something. And so, and the way that he is, he's very, there's a sense of respect and a way of being to him.
Authority.
Pardon me?
Authority.
Yeah, it's authoritative.
Inspires other people.
And what do you think is about him that also you see in this character?
He's deeply compassionate.
to the guy you know as a friend and as an actor.
He's a deeply compassionate man. He's a highly intelligent man because he's questioning. He has questions about everything. He doesn't always ask those questions out loud. He doesn't always let you know.
But
he's very, very much, he's very, very much the compassionate person, almost in a heroic way for a lot of people. He, for a lot of people, is quite a heroic figure in a lot of ways, I think.
Is this a different movie in that it somehow it has an impact on you beyond what it does for career? You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a life-altering kind of experience, yeah. Because it's, because first of all, it asks of us so much. The Wachowski brothers ask everything for us to show up and just give everything that we
physically, emotionally,
because they are, because they're giving everything, and so is every member of the crew. And so, of course, the actors are asked the same, but it's such a high level of intensity. And to show up like that, and to believe in something so much that you want to show up like that, and you love showing up like that, even when it's so hard, it changes you. It has for me anyway. And to also be part of something that I think metaphysically, on a spiritual level, says such important things about life and
about compassion, all the things that Keanu talked about.
It's so deep. I mean, every line for me, I can take somewhere if I want. And you know, and I know that people do that. That's why, that's what the websites are about. People are hearing one line, and that one line is inspiring them to think and to have conversations. I was thinking about a line that is in the film where Seraph says to Neo, "You don't know someone until you fought them." And you know, it's true. Until you've seen someone's dark and light, you don't really know them. I mean, I'm taking that physical thing that he's saying, and I'm saying that it means something more. And the brothers are saying that with the film, and that's just a really simple example of how deep the rabbit hole goes, mm-hmm. which they talk about in the first film.
You were a star when you made this movie. Did you eagerly look forward to coming back to the second one? Yeah. Because of all that it is. Because it's a character you...
That's a lovely role. I thought, that, you know, Larry and Andrew wrote beautiful scripts. And, you know, getting to work with these lovely people and artists.
To be involved in something of this nature that has become such a touchstone for people, it's become so much a part of the lexicon. That's the life-altering stuff. We won't even realize how much our lives will be altered, I think, until many years after the matrices.
Do you really mean that?
Yes, I do.
You don't know how our lives as a culture influenced by this movie, or are you individual
lives? I'm talking about
individual lives who participated.
The people who participated in it won't really have a true understanding of how much this movie will affect our lives until many years after.
You have done a lot on stage mm-hmm. in a variety of movies and some of the great characters mm-hmm. on stage, sir. Mm-hmm. And this put this at the top.
I put this in the gallery. This is another feather in my cap. This is a very large feather.
Yeah,
he's a very, very, you know, big, larger than life character. But he is, and he may be the character that I am most remembered for, and that's fine. I've made my peace with that. My peace with that. That may be a reality for me. I don't know, Charlie. You know, I still believe I have a lot to do. I think I have some more tricks in my bag.
But you may not be able to find any, again in your career, in your lifetime as an actor, a character like this that has such a penetrating impact.
Worldwide? No, probably not.
Yeah, this is a worldwide phenomenon. This is a movie that has...
But the one thing that I want to really be clear also is that it also is going to change the way movies are made forever. Mm-hmm. Because what these guys have done is they've figured out certain technological advances that alter the process of picture making.
But that has to do with what?
Just how they've told the story using the technology that we have. How they've altered the way we watch a story. We've lived our lives seeing in a cutting style, a convention that goes back to the dawn of cinema, where we see master shots and close-ups and over the shoulders, and we cut in a way that tells us things. And they've told the story sometimes never doing that, just having the camera go where it wants to go and see what it wants to see, and never having to cut it.
Well, how come they were so smart?
Because they are really smart.
They're bright guys.
They're brilliant.
But they're thoughtful, with intent.
But they've been able to understand. They have an ability to understand how the technology can be used.
Affects you. Not only what it can do, but how it affects you, I think, is really the dialogue that they've, you know, that they're investigating how we watch a film in terms of editing styles. You know, by punching in, they're really on a different kind of cinematic vernacular that is touches us in a different way. That is very modern. It's not this is how you unfold the story. It's like actually we can jump in here, we can go in here, we can move like this, and you can be affected by what they're trying to communicate, I think, in a very modern way.
And the tempo and the pacing of the movie is very unusual.
Okay, but so what's a guy like you, a well-known Hollywood producer who made Lethal Weapon and a whole bunch of movies, what are you going to do now? you have made this.
I mean,
you've been involved with genius.
I mean, I met these two brothers.
It's a great question.
It made my life better.
Made your life better?
Oh yeah, this movie, these two brothers from Chicago made my life better. They
made your life better because they made you appreciate where you could go. They raised the bar for Joel Silver.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
And for everybody. You know, and for me, they showed me something. Like I for years worked in an action genre that every 10 minutes there was an action beat, the pacing was such, it had a move, etc. They altered all of that. They look at picture making different, and you know, consequently, it allows you to think about movies differently and think about what stories we can tell that are different. I mean, what the technology is doing, Charlie, is technology is changing our business more than it ever has changed since 1913. I mean,
we're right at the beginning.
Yeah, absolutely.
And also, everyone. I think, just to add to what Joel said, what it's really done in terms of the action genre, it's allowed you to go see an action movie and think while you're watching the movie.
Be entertained and provoked.
You're entertained and you're titillated and all of that, but you're also asked to think about some things.
And it gives you something of meaning if you want it.
Yeah.
That's the meaning. Has meaning for yourself.
Yeah.
When you look back on this, tell me the most significant impact, Keanu, of this movie.
The most significant
on you.
Impact. You know, I don't want to distill that to one to one element. I think it's been the experience as a as an actor and as a person, and I can't. That is not one.
It's too difficult to say. I mean, as I said to you before, we won't fully know. We won't really have any idea just how much this is going to impact our lives until it's well behind us. I said to Carrie-Anne when we finished doing the first Matrix, I remember saying to you, don't forget that we've done something extraordinary together. That we did something really extraordinary together. We spent 9 months together and we changed our bodies and we did things that we never thought we could ever do. And then the film came out and changed cinema, so we won't know.
It is amazing the amount of attention this has got. I mean, this is the look at this. This is from Newsweek December 2000 year, The Matrix, two sequels, fanatic fans, an exclusive preview to Time magazine last week. Secrets of the new Matrix. We're the first to see the movie and play the video game. If we told you everything, they would have to kill us. I thank you all for joining us.
Now that you've heard from the cast and producer of The Matrix Reloaded, we turn to two journalists offering a different perspective on the phenomenon. With us this evening is Kurt Anderson. He is the author and host of the radio show Studio 360. And Devin Gordon, he is the general editor of Arts and Leisure at Newsweek magazine. He was the only journalist allowed inside the Matrix camp and the first to see the footage. I am pleased to have both of them here. You have not seen the movie Matrix Reloaded.
I have not.
But you understand, because of your own role as a cultural critic and because you understand sort of the notion of the future, what's going on? What is the popularity of the Matrix series?
Well, I think it pulled together in 1999 lots of things that were in the air. I think about it in terms as a comparison to Star Wars, which was an equally huge thing in 77 when it opened. And Star Wars, in its good against evil, good against the Empire, is a very Cold War movie. Matrix pulled together are kind of this sense that we are all connected by the internet, sort of video game ideas, and made up what was suddenly a very plausible idea that computers, you know, the technology that has done such amazing things lately is kind of could control us in a way.
And machines just could have a life and they could dominate us and they
exactly.
could, in fact.
Exactly. And like Star Wars, has a sort of nice Joseph Campbell, New Age, philosophical underpinning that, you know, appeals to people and becomes almost a kind of religious experience for people who love it.
And I also believe it is because of, they've used the martial arts and choreographed them to almost dance.
Indeed. And again, took, as Star Wars was this great pastiche of sort of pulp sources, The Matrix took, you know, Hong Kong action films that had begun that and had done that there and took it to Hollywood in a way that was just stunning to people and seemed entirely fresh.
They say it made change movies. It changed movies how?
It changed movies by sort of rewriting the book on how intelligent an action movie could be and how you could shoot action. I think every single commercial, every single movie that has any kind of fight scene since that, even the way you score a movie, changed by the way The Matrix sound, the way The Matrix looked. I mean, you can see it on catwalks and fashion studios.
We forget the style was a huge part of it.
The style is a huge part of it. I actually got an email shortly after my story ran in Newsweek that asked me if the clothing was on sale anywhere in England. I had to inform the poor guy that there was
no
way
that you could
get it.
You did? This was your first story.
Yeah.
2003, this is written in December, I think. Mm-hmm. 2003, Year of The Matrix. Two mm-hmm. sequels, fanatic fans, an exclusive preview. The Wachowski brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever talked to them?
I have never met them. I've never even seen
they
them.
They won't even talk to you.
I think I was within 50 feet of them once, but I'm not certain. I
can't
confirm that.
What is all this secrecy about?
I'm not sure. The actors in the movie and all the people around them say that the Wachowskis are just very shy guys, that they want the movies to speak for themselves. I'm sure that is true to a certain extent. I'm sure that they know because the movies are going to be huge that once they open the door, you can't shut it. I'm sure that's an element of it. But these guys know comic books. They know mythology. They know the gothic mythology that comes with a lot of comic books. And I think they understand the wizards behind the curtain persona. And I think they really like to push that. They're comic
book geeks. Do you think they were motivated by all that? I mean, their own love of the narrative, the Greek
oh, absolutely.
Legend and narrative and
these guys,
story.
By all accounts, these guys consume everything. If you name it, they've read it in one way or another. And you're talking about everything from Schopenhauer to Jeff Darrow comic books. They've read
and
everything.
And Cornel West.
And Cornel West, who does have a small and rather amusing role in the movie.
Yeah. This movie, I said this to Joel Silver, the producer, it's very hard to beat the first one
mm-hmm.
in any movie.
Mm-hmm.
Sequels rarely. Godfather
I'd say impossible.
The best exception.
I'd say impossible, actually. Yeah,
Godfather
not just
2
there.
Is an exception.
Yeah, I Godfather 2, yeah, I guess. But
okay.
but I think it would have been impossible to top The Matrix with this movie. I don't think it could have been done.
And
no, and
it doesn't.
I think it comes. A lot of critics so far think that it doesn't come very close. I think it comes closer than they give it credit for, and I think some distance from the movie will show that. I think this is a very tough movie to go in and see once and really understand. I remember enjoying the first Matrix the first time I saw it, but I don't remember really getting it.
So you watched it seven times or something?
Oh, well, that's a low estimate, but yeah, that's good.
When you went to Duke, you were a bright guy. I mean, each time you learn something more. You
there's
catch
always
a
something. There's
that
always
miss.
Something to find. I mean, I remember. I think it was probably like the fifth or sixth time that I watched the movie that I noticed that Neo in the very first scene that you see him lives in apartment number 101, which anybody who's read 1984 knows that 101 is the room where your worst nightmare lives.
Did you? This is why it's so commercially brilliant. Of course, because young men like Devin are going to go pay $10 seven times to see it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, but does it? What impact does it have on the culture, not on the movie business and all that it had? It affects.
I think it's a big action movie with all the candy that action movies give you. But it has
quality?
A point of view. Well, it has certainly quality, but it has a point of view about life and how life should be lived, and seems to have meaning rather than, you know, X-Men is fine, but it's just an old-fashioned story, whereas this purports to explain existence and heroism.
And it has a messianic, Christ-like figure.
Yeah, it does indeed. And an ambivalent.
And every great narrative, every great story needs a hero, right?
Yeah, certainly.
Every myth needs a hero.
Every myth needs a hero, probably every story, and certainly every $100 million film needs a hero.
If you haven't seen Revolutions...
No, you see bits and pieces of it at the very end of the second movie. If you stick around through the 9 minutes of credits, you can see about a minute and a half of
Revolutions. Tell me what each of the trilogy does. The Matrix first does what?
The first Matrix is what comic book fans and movie fans, really serious movie fans, will refer to as an origin story. It's sort of the birth of a hero kind of story. And by the end of the first movie, you have a man who has realized his identity is and what his destiny is. The second movie is about the choices and the responsibilities that come
with
that.
And slaying the dragons.
Basically, yeah. And the choices that have to come between life and love.
And the third? Revolution, but you know what I mean. They must be
the third movie is about the resolution between man versus machines. And I think that what's interesting about what I'm expecting to happen in the third movie, and I'm not certain it's going to happen in the third movie, but the way the trilogy is going is that people expect man to slay the machines. They expect a resolution to the war. I'd be surprised if that happens. Just judging by the way I feel like the Wachowskis think and the way the movies have gone thus far.
How do they think?
The way they think is much more philosophical. They think in balances, and they don't see this as sort of a war that is going to be won by one or the other. I'd be surprised if there's not some sort of truce, in a way of speaking, at the very end of this. The way that you see...
A kind of acceptance and coexistence
between... Yeah, I think the groundwork is laid and reloaded, where you see that there's a conversation in which there's a discussion about whether or not man can exist without machines, but whether or not machines can exist without man. And I think we're already getting to that point. That's one of the things that's interesting about Reloaded, is the way in which we're already dependent on our technology to the point where how would we exist without it?
We're slaves to it, sort of.
Yeah.
You know, and a dozen years ago, this movie wouldn't have had the resonance because the ubiquity of computers and the net and all the rest of it makes it seem we can almost touch it. It seems almost real. And, you know, a movie like Total Recall, the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, came out a dozen years ago.
Yeah.
It did okay. But
how about Terminator?
Well, indeed. And those did what they did, but I don't think they... I think there's a sense in which this now feels like the day after tomorrow rather than some absolute sci-fi.
Okay, but so what's the impact of that? It feels like the day after tomorrow. That makes it more real, more interesting, more compelling?
Well, and I think it gives people, it confirms the sort of thrills and sort of dark doubts people have about technology in a general way, and sort of affects the way they think about technological choices going forward.
I mean, what amazes me is how they have touched on so many of the ideas that I have touched on this program with people like Bill Joy. Nanotechnology, replication, so much of the stuff, robotics.
Well, they're probably watching all of those episodes. Wachowski probably. That's probably one of the reasons why. I mean, they just devour things.
They devour the whole idea of the future, like no other movie maker.
And then it goes back and forth. I mean, we've had in the past where science fiction of the 40s and the 50s basically informed the space program. I mean, you know, science fiction becomes science and it goes back and forth. Yeah.
That's a fascinating idea. I mean, both of you reflect on that. I mean, they are, some people involved in this movie are saying that this movie and what it does, and this is writ very large, is going to have an influence on the social engineers of the future.
Well, I think it certainly, you know, Bill Joy, 100,000 300,000 people read his long essays warning us about where we may go with technology.
Magazine, right.
Tens of millions of people see this, so I do think it begins in that broad, popular way. Begin to start the conversation in normal people's houses and brains about maybe, you know, there are some choices to make here about, rather than letting technology just take us where it will, that we can guide it this way or that.
And the special effects coordinator of the movie, John Gaeta, who's a brilliant guy,
yeah.
When I was talking to him about the technology that they've come up with for this movie called virtual cinematography, they call it, where they can basically create a human being, a photorealistic human being, with computers out of thin air. And one of his interesting perspectives on that was that when I asked him who could possibly top this technology, what he was saying was, well, the military can do it. They're the next level of people that you can expect to see this kind of technology. In fact, he assumes they can do it better than that.
So the medium sort of becomes the message in a certain way. The technological marvels of this movie are what the movie's about.
Thank you, Marshall.
Dan, it's been always a pleasure to be here.
Marshall McLuhan first said the medium is a message, didn't he? Thank you very much. It's great to see you. Studio 360, Kurt Anderson, heard here in New York on Sunday night, I don't know when, around the country.
Around the country.
Depends on, check your public radio and other outlets.
Public radio.
Public radio. Thank you. Pleasure to have you on the broadcast.
thank you for joining us for this one-hour program about a movie that everybody will be talking about. It's been on the cover of news magazines and a lot of other magazines, and we're pleased to have had the producer and the stars of the movie, as well as two people who look at it with an intelligent eye. Thank you for joining us. See you next time. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
The Coca-Cola system sponsors youth sports the world over, like a national soccer tournament for 37,000 English girls and boys. All young people need to be encouraged to keep active, satisfying a thirst for healthy competition. The Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.